What is a triode and how does it work? A triode is an electronic amplifying device belonging to the vacuum tube family. In electronics, a vacuum tube is a device that controls electric current flow in a high vacuum between electrodes to which an electric potential difference has been applied. There are many types of vacuum tubes depending on their use. They are essentially used for a number of fundamental electronic functions such as signal amplification and current rectification. JAES, in its catalog, offers a wide range of triodes from different manufacturers. In the Anglo-Saxon countries, the triode is simply called valve, since it allows to vary the current that passes through it. Very often, to explain the basic principle of its operation, the triode is compared to a tap that controls the release of a liquid or gas. The triode was born as a natural evolution of the diode. As we already explained in our previous video, the function of a diode is to allow the flow of electric current in one direction and virtually block it in the opposite direction. The diode is in fact mainly composed of two electrodes called anode and cathode. The electron flow conventionally goes from the cathode to the anode following this direction. Opposite polarization of the diode will oppose a virtually infinite resistance. The diode blocks the current, reducing it to zero. Unlike the diode, the triode, as the name suggests, is provided with a third electrode placed between the cathode and the anode called control grid. All these elements are placed inside a tube in which a vacuum has been created, which means that all the air and other gases have been removed. For a triode to actually work, it is necessary to create a strong potential difference between its anode and cathode. For this reason, the cathode is heated by the separate current flowing through a thin metal filament in order to emit electrons via thermionic emission. In this type of triode, the grid usually consists of a cylindrical screen or helix of fine wire surrounded but never touching the cathode. The grid acts like a gate for the electrons, controlling the current flow and thus allowing signal amplification. Around the grid is placed the anode, which receives the electrons emitted by the cathode. This is a fairly simplified representation of the triode, which means that only the basic elements of the tube are shown, as we can also notice in its symbol, where the cathode and the anode are separated by the grid, which is represented by this dashed line. As in the diode, the anode collects the electrons emitted by the cathode, which are not hindered by the grid, since they can easily pass through its coils. However, the grid can significantly influence the movement of the electrons towards the anode, if there's an electric potential difference between the grid and the cathode. Basically, when there's no voltage on the grid, the current between the cathode and anode will be at its maximum. On the other hand, a less negative or positive voltage on the grid will allow more electrons through. Let's see how. We can observe how the grid is able to vary the current flow by drawing the characteristic curves of the tube. Now, we are going to apply different voltage values between the anode and cathode to find out the corresponding current. The applied voltage is called anode voltage, while the current flowing through the tube is called anodic current. To perform the measurements, we will use this circuit. As we can see here, the grid and the cathode are connected, so they have the same voltage. Thanks to this circuit, we will see how the triode behaves when the voltage between the grid and the cathode, which is called grid voltage and it is indicated with the abbreviation VG, is equal to zero. When the grid and cathode have the same electric potential, then the triode can be compared to a diode. That's because the grid does not affect the anode current. We obtain a characteristic curve which is similar to the curve of a diode. It is necessary to bring the grid to a different electric potential than the cathode in order to observe its influence on the anodic current. So let's try to connect a battery between these two electrodes. The voltage of this battery is 2 volts. We connect its positive pole to the cathode and its negative pole to the grid. Now, the electric potential of the grid is 2 volts less than the cathode electric potential. So the grid voltage is equal to minus 2 volts. In this scheme, we can notice that the curve obtained with a negative grid voltage lies on the right of the curve obtained with a grid voltage equal to 0. We can now assume that, when we apply a certain anode voltage to the triode, the resulting anodic current is as small as the grid voltage is more negative. In the scheme, we can see that when the triode operates under point A conditions, in which the anode voltage is 100 volt and the grid voltage is 0 volt, the resulting anodic current will be 12 milliamps. When instead the triode operates under point B conditions, in which the anode voltage is always 100 volt, but the grid voltage is now minus 2 volt, the anodic current will be just 6 milliamps. This is a very interesting example that allows us to understand that the anodic current in a triode depends not only on the anode voltage, as in the case of the diode, but it also depends on the grid voltage. In fact, it is possible to change the anodic current by only changing the grid voltage and leaving the anode voltage unaltered. That's because the electrons emitted by the cathodes, besides being attracted by the anode, are now experiencing a repulsive force of the negatively charged grid. For this reason, only the fastest electrons emitted by the cathode can pass through the grid and reach the anode, forming the so-called anodic current. Actually, in the triode, as in the diode, an electron cloud is formed around the cathode. This negatively charged electron cloud, along with the grid, prevents the electrons to move towards the anode. But why in the diode we cannot control the repulsive action that the electron cloud is exerting on the electrons, in the triode we can just simply change the grid voltage. Looking at this scheme, we can observe a very important fact. As we already seen, we can reduce the anodic current from 12 milliamps to 6 milliamps by just bringing the grid voltage from 0 volt to minus 2 volt, and thus leaving the 100 volt anode voltage unchanged. However, the anodic current can be reduced in the opposite way, by changing the anode voltage and leaving the 0 volt grid voltage unchanged. In this case, the triode shall operate under point C condition, in which the anodic current is 6 milliamps and the grid voltage is 0 volt. In this scheme, we can see that this can be achieved by reducing the anode voltage from 100 volt to 60 volt. Quite a big variation, don't you think? From all these considerations, we can assume that if we want to change the grid voltage to reduce the anodic current from 12 milliamps to 6 milliamps, a simple variation from 0 volt to minus 2 volt is required. On the other hand, if we want to change the anodic voltage and achieve the same result, a variation from 100 volt to 60 volt is required. This means a 40 volt variation, which is 20 times greater than the previous one. Thanks to the small distance between the grid and the cathode, the grid has more effective action on the anodic current compared to the anode, which is further away from the cathode. We can conclude by saying that the triode grid is able to control the anodic current by changing its own voltage. If you found this video useful, please let us know by leaving a like and a comment. You can also share it. And don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. Find out our next project by visiting jaescompany.com.